Thank you, Andrew, and thank you for inviting me here. And thank you for people who stayed a bit longer. I was getting very worried. So anyway, so yeah, first of all, I'm a political scientist. I should say it up front. But not the kind that Adam mentioned. I do not believe that we are threatened in the Northwest Passage, and we will talk about that, but it's good because Adam done a bit of groundwork for me, so I'll go faster on that one. And also, the title of my presentation is really, I put the term not Northern Canada, but Inuit Nunangat, which means Inuit being the population, and Nunangat used to be called Nunat. Nunat means land in Inuktitut, and Nunangat means land and sea. So that has a nice twist for sovereignty on the Northwest Passage, by the way, and that's why they choose it. It's not for anything. And, you know, on the two pictures here, you have new boats. They're not here yet, the new Arctic operating boats that are supposed to be built soon. And then you get Canadian Ranger, which are originally Inuit and that are working on the ground for the sovereignty. And what I want to try, the case I'm trying to make here, and I work mostly with Inuit, so... And it's been in political development, basically, you know, Nunavut and Nunavik on the self-government. And really what I'm trying to show you is in the Arctic, there's something happening in terms of international relations that I haven't seen in another place, but anyway, I'm more specialized in the Arctic. It's that we, in the Canadian Arctic, in the Arctic, and not only the Canadian, in the Arctic in general, there's a post-Westphalian space that's opening. I don't know if you're aware, but it's a political science international relation terminology, but the Westphalian space is the idea that nation state holds sovereignty, and they defend it. The classical view since 1648, the Westphalia Treaty, and it's a view, basically. So who's going to defend, you know, that the defense of Canada is vested in the government of Canada as a nation state, and that's the classical view, and still very, and I'll show it through that presentation, it's still very alive. But there's an alternative view of that, is that sovereignty and security is maybe not only the state, it's also our actors, NGOs. And in the case of the Arctic, what's really interesting is that the NGOs are Aboriginal NGOs. And they have and they're very effective because they're transnational NGOs. If you look at the Inuit, and I should move to the next one, that's Inuit Nunangat for the Canadian part, but the Inuit are in two territories and a province, and two provinces in fact, but they're also in Greenland, which is Denmark, and Siberia, and Alaska, sorry, forgot. There's a sizable, so they go, you know, the people without borders, in a way. And the other group that's part of that process is the Sami. And the Sami are also interesting. The Sami are all over Scandinavia and Russia. So they also bridge. And the third group is the Athapascan. And the Athapascan, between the US and Canada as well. So those Aboriginal people have bridged and have pushed cooperation. At the time, during the Cold War, even. And that's what's interesting. You know, ICC, the Inuit organization, was founded in 1978. And at the time, the Cold War was still in. And they were trying to get linked with the Siberian Inuit. Small population, by the way. But, you know, they were bridging. So, and that's why I'm saying, you know, there's a different space that's been created there. Anyway, so. I wanted you maybe to understand also... Canadian Arctic policies. Like Adam says it, we're very edgy on sovereignty in the Arctic. At the same time, we haven't done very much for it, I would argue. Basically, we got a transfer from the British Crown that, in fact, Canadians were not that interested in at that time. It took a while and negotiation. In fact, it took 10 years before Canada accepted those islands, the Arctic islands, mostly. And then they accepted it, and it took another 15 years, so they started to, you know, look at it. And I just put a quote from a civil servant at the time who said, you know, well, quote adequately, you know, the British government gave something, he didn't know what exactly it was, because most of the islands were undiscovered at that time. And to the Canadian government, we didn't know what he was getting, basically. And the interesting thing, yeah, so fairly a lack of interest in terms politically and in terms of investment. And there's only been response to threats. And I put perceived, because very often perceived. The first response to the Canadian government was the threat of whalers, mostly American and Scottish, and the Norwegian explorers. Because most of the Arctic has been explored by Norwegians, by the way. So we had, that's why all the islands are called Ellesmeyer, Seleibergs, and there's a few other one Norwegian names, because they've been discovered by Norwegians first. So we sent Louis-Elzéar Bernier, a guy from Lille in Quebec, that went and put the flag, the Canadian flag, all over the island. That was the first Canadian sovereignty at that point, and there's still some remnant of that. The Russian, during the Cold War, we got the Dew Line, but the Dew Line was brought and paid by the US in totality. So, and then the question of the Arctic sovereignty, too, is interesting. You know, the Canadian government had threatened by Inuit from Greenland. They were using Ellesmere Island as a hunting ground. And, you know, same thing. You know, the title on the land was not too strong, so they decided to relocate some Inuit from Inukjuak, which is northern Quebec in Nunavik now, to move them up to Ellesmere Island to make sure there was a population there, because before that, Ellesmere Island had nobody living there. The only people who would go to Ellesmere Island were the Greenlandic Inuit from Karnak, Tulé. So, and those relocations in the 50s have been very contentious, and there's been some conversation for them, no excuse so far. But, you know, for most experts, you know, there was a strong element of Canada trying, maybe sovereignty might be a strong word, but trying to get Canadian population in on that island. Then Adam talked about the tankers and the polar sea, so, you know, perceived threat here because of that. But what struck me in northern Canada, I go very often there, is the lack of investment of Canada. And in fact, most of the investment in northern Canada are U.S. investment. If you look at the Kujuak Airport, you look at the Iqaluit Airport, you look at the Inuvik Airport, all built by the U.S. during the Second World War and the Cold War. The Kujurapik again. So most of the infrastructure, the big one in the Arctic, are American. Dew Line, all of that. And the Canadian government hasn't invested very much in that region, and that's an issue. And there's the Nasivik port, Adam was talking about that, and they're cutting down and cutting down. And Nasivik is also interesting, you know. You're building a deep sea port in Nasivik. Nasivik has only a small community beside, it's Arctic Bay, about 300 people. There's no deep sea port in all of Nunavut, the northern part. It means, you know, the cost, Adam was talking about that, the cost of food is really expensive because it comes by plane, or it comes by barge in the summer. Barge means they can't land. If you go to Iqaluit, the boat has to go 1 kilometer from the shore, and then you have to take small boats to bring it to the community. Anyway. So lack of investment. And so that makes, in some way, that makes Canada weak in the north. Not in the sovereignty, because nobody challenged Canadian sovereignty. Nobody. Even the state. The Northwest Passage is not an issue of sovereignty. It's an issue of transit. So Canadian sovereignty is not threatened by anybody. And that's a quote from one of the prime ministers, 50s, Louis Saint-Laurent, that sums up, I think, very much the way Canada has dealt with that. And it's changing, but not so much, and I will make the argument. So if we look at those ideas, sovereignty, development, and security in terms of Canadian policy, and after we look at the Inuit view, is since the 50s, there's been a move since Louis Saint-Laurent, which is we barely dealt with the Arctic, there was a move towards a focus on political and social development, the land claim, the GBNQA, the Nunavut Agreement, all those things. So, and resource development as well was bad, but at that time didn't work very well anyway. And so we've been transitioning from military security to environmental and human security after the Cold War, very much. And that brought us to the Arctic Council. I'll go a bit further on the Arctic Council, but the Arctic Council, Canada was one of the founders of the Arctic Council, and it's a very important element. The present Canadian government focused on asserting Canadian sovereignty, military security, and northern resource development. Those are the main elements that are moved. So we've been moving to from human security, in a way, back to military security. And an example is Operation Nanook, where every year the military go to the north to show the Canadian flag, basically, to show that Canadians are there, only in the summer, mind you. We don't have icebreaker to go in the winter. So sovereignty is only in the summer. And so what I would argue is Canadian policy has shifted over time from human development to resource development and from human security to military security. And that's been a shift that we see. And I'll go further on that in the end. So unresolved issue, what we have, or threats, if you want. So one is we have a contention with Denmark on Hans Island. That's a small island there, just in the very small passage. It's almost resolved. We had a few flag exchange. You know, Canadian went put a flag, then the Danish went put a pull of the Canadian flag and put the Danish flag anyway. There's not room for many flags on that island anyway. So that's one thing. So it's almost solved. So with US, we have two, the Beaufort Sea border, which is a small issue, and the Northwest Passage. Northwest Passage, like Adam said it, there's nothing there, I think, it's going to happen. But the Beaufort Sea was a bit more complicated. It's the issue of a border between the extension of a Canadian US border between Alaska and Yukon, in fact, in the Beaufort Sea. So you see the little pie here is the disagreement. Well, it's important because there's oil right there. So that's a question. Although some experts say that, you know, if you keep going the line, in fact, if you take the American line, which is more on the right, it moves more to the west after that. If you choose that baseline, if you choose the other one, then Canada gets more. So anyway, it's almost resolved also. So no big issue there. And we're not going to go to war for that one. That's for sure. And then with Denmark, Russia, Norway, and USA, there's all the question of the EEZ, the economic zones, extended economic zone. So, and that's more complicated. You see that everybody is claiming, you know, the idea who owns the North Pole, basically. And so right now it's based on the study of the continental shelf. But year two, there's no big issue because the UNCLO, the United Nations Law of the Sea, is dealing with that. So it's going to be a long process, and there'll be also a lot of negotiation between the parties. And you know, right now we've seen some. Norwegian have an agreement with the Russian on the Barents Sea. So you know, we see that it's working. So those are the issues in the Arctic. So they're not very dramatic, I would say. And we'll see how it goes for the sharing the North Pole or the Polar Sea. But anyway. That was a little comic, Hans Island. How do you make Hans Island Canadian? That's the best way. So, it's about the size of the island. So, yeah, that would have been a good idea. Okay, so now if we move to the Inuit, because from the Inuit perspective, that doesn't count very much. And what I argue, I put a quote from, it's from Ulrike Hansen. She's the co-chair of the Arctic People and Security Research Pillar. She's from Nunavut. And really, you know, she stressed that. You know, from the question of sovereignty for Inuit is only from the point of view of human security. You know, so it's not about icebreaker, it's not about military capacity, it's about people. Or can we provide security as a sovereign country without first defining what the full list of threats is? And the threats to Inuit population are not the Russian bomber. They're not the American icebreaker either. So for many Inuit families, these are still very basic. Inability to provide accessible, affordable, and safe food. Food security is an issue in the Arctic. Water and housing is more real and immediate than any threat from outside border, the outside of our border. So just to give you an idea, I'll give you some stats. That's the life expectancy in Canada. The lowest part, Nunavut, Nunavik. 10 years lower than the southern Canada. But that's an issue of human security. There's many calls to that. I won't have time to go through that today. But you know, that's an unresolved issue. It's an issue of human security. In a you know, first world country, you expect people to have roughly the same life expectancy. Northern Quebec and Northern Nunavut don't have those level. Suicide. That's another issue of human security. Highest threat in the world. So, you know, I teach Inuit students. They all have somebody, they know all somebody that has committed suicide. So it makes it a bit rough. Infant mortality rate, it's coming down, but it's still 4 times than the rest of Canada. So, you know, that's another issue. Just some example. And housing condition, overcrowding, huge issue in northern Canada. And that has an impact. You know, shelter, basic, you know, food security, basic human security. So when you live in a crowded house, there's all kind of, you know, violence, abuse, inability to go to school to study. That poses lots of problems. And tuberculosis. In fact, the only place in Canada where we still have tuberculosis is northern Canada. In Kangasujoak this winter, it's 800 people, there was 100 people with tuberculosis. But tuberculosis comes from the American water, by the way. It's a long story, but the brand, it's still alive in northern community because of housing. You know, that's really conducive to that. So Inuit diplomacy, I wanted to get back to that because, you know, I don't want to portray, we tend to portray Inuit as, you know, having problems, but they've been also very upfront in trying to change things. So, and, you know, the first element I talked about the Inuit Circumpolar Conference, that's been founded by an American, by the way, an Inupiat from Alaska, Eben Hobson, with the oil revenue, that's interesting, Prudhoe Bay, got enough money, invited all the Inuit from the world to get together and create that international Inuit Circumpolar Conference. The sovereign Inuit were not here at the founding, 178, there was no way they could travel. But eventually they will get there. So, and ICC has been really working on environmental security, saving, and the issue where the persistent organic pollutants that came up, the ozone layers at the time, and the climate change. Those are the issues that have an impact on Inuit life. You know, climate change, you know, we don't see it in the south. I go to the north all the time. It's amazing what's been happening. You know, you go in Iqaluit in November, the bay is open water. It used to freeze in September. It's, and year after year. So change in the Arctic are going much, much faster than anywhere else. That means that people, you know, they used to unseal on the ice. They don't. The ice is not safe anymore in many places. There's lots of old ice and that kind of thing, but not good ice for hunting, not anymore. And they put the first Inuit were the first one to put the Inuit regional conservation strategy. That was a circumpolar strategy to protect the Inuit environment. Because that's something interesting. You know, the Inuit, they don't see themselves as separated from the environment. They are the environment. They are part of it. So, you know, land claim and self-government in Canada, that's also very interesting. You know, the Inuit people have negotiated, all the Inuit from Canada have negotiated a land claim. You know, being in Labrador, in northern Quebec, in Nunavut, in Nouvelle-Aluit also as well. So that's, and two self-government, Nunavut government and Nunatsiavut government in Labrador. And both governments are, you know, are in operation now. So they were also key to the Arctic environmental protection strategy that was put together with all the Arctic states. And that was, in fact, the starting point of the Arctic Council. And the Arctic Council, they were there at the creation as well. And the Arctic Council, if you don't know it, was very interesting. The Arctic Council has 8 states, all the 8 Arctic states, 3 Scandinavian countries, Russia, Canada, and 4. Denmark is, 4 Finland, Norway, and Sweden, and Denmark. Anyway, and so 8 nation states, but beside the 8 nation states, there's 3 permanent participants, and those are the Aboriginal organization, the Athapascan, the Inuit, and the Sami. And they're part of that council. So what I'm saying, you know, defining a post-Westphalian space is that, is having amongst a council, the state and the Aboriginal organization, plus observer for other state. But so, you know, the Arctic Council was really moving towards more cooperation and inclusion of other actors in the Arctic. So more open process. Mind you, the Arctic Council has no jurisdiction on security, military issues, sovereignty, only environmental and sustainable development and research. That's the only mandate. And SAR, search and rescue. That's the mandate of the Arctic Council. It's a very limited mandate, but it was a very creative organization. So, and then we move back to the Arctic 5. I told you, you know, the Arctic Council, that's the Arctic 8, plus the permanent participant, the Aboriginal organization. Arctic 5 was a meeting conducted in Ilulissat in Greenland and Chelsea, 2010 in Chelsea in Canada. And the idea was to get together all the five countries who have a claim on the North Pole, basically, you know, borderline states. And it's interesting, so I put two statements, and the first is from the official statement from the meeting that was chaired by Canada. And so basically we discussed the value of having a national agency, so national, responsible for public safety issue and the threat and having cooperation consistent with national law. So it's a big emphasis on the nation, a Westphalian view of the world. And it was very interesting because after the meeting, Hillary Clinton, who was at the meeting, she's there, she made a statement saying she didn't think it was the right way of dealing with that. The Arctic 5 was not a good idea, and she said significant international discussion on Arctic issues should include those who have legitimate interest and Aboriginal people that were excluded for that meeting. Because that's the thing, the Arctic 5 was only the head of a state. So, and you see there's a tension between those two models, and since, you know, over the last years there's been an emphasis on conflict, and if you go on conflict then the state come back. Less cooperation. And the reaction, the Inuit didn't stand doing nothing, they issue their own sovereignty declaration. And it's interesting, you know, so basically the conduct of international relations in the Arctic and the resolution of international disputes in the Arctic are not the sole preserve of Arctic state, so post-Westphalian pitch, clearly. We need multi-level organization, multi-level governance means states with other people, and must transcend Arctic state agenda and sovereign right and the traditional monopoly claimed by the state in the area of foreign affairs. So it's a challenge, clearly, to that. And it's a challenge from the Inuit from all over the country, the Inuit from Greenland, Nunavik, Nunavut, Labrador, and so on, until Siberia. So, and the issue of sovereignty and sovereign rights in the Arctic are becoming inextricably linked to issue of self-determination in the Arctic. Inuit and the Arctic state must therefore work together closely. So it's really a pitch to get them back into the, and you know, the Arctic Council, basically. You know, saying, it's not the Arctic 5 that we should create, it's to give more power to the Arctic Council, because it's a more creative organization. So, and we have that time right now, and Canada is chairing the Arctic Council right now, so we don't know where it's going to go, we're hoping for the best. Leona Glukak is an Inuk from Nunavut, by the way, so she's from the region, so we're hoping for the best, and we'll see how it goes, but clearly there's a tension here between two views of who should deal with the Arctic. So in conclusions, yeah, we clearly witnessed the construction of a post-Westphalian space in the Arctic, I would argue. It's been clearly because of the Cold War. And you have to understand, you know, the Inuit were able to be the broker in that movement because of the Cold War. Nobody was speaking with the Russian about cooperation, not the state, but the Inuit could speak about cooperation. So they were very important at that time. That's why they were able to gain so much ground. So the ICC, Sami, Athabaskan Arctic Council. But the Westphalian logic is coming back. The Arctic 5, the UNCLOS 2. United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, is a Westphalian framework. Only the state are dealing with borders. And the Russian and Canadian Arctic policy, or at least declaration, I should say, maybe not policy, because both those countries are pushing an agenda around sovereignty, national sovereignty. And that's been over the years. And you can see that, you know, the American are not, with Hillary Clinton, but the Scandinavian either are not. So there's an interesting tension right now between two views of, you know, oh, we should work on the Arctic. So thank you, Nakamek. Any question? Yeah.
Question, comment is about the idea that modern Canadian policy has gone back to the hard security and sovereignty position. And my view of it, you may disagree, is that it's window dressing. That the Canadian government, the way it's been working, at least since Harper was elected, is that on the one hand you do have, you know, sovereignty, security, armed icebreakers, new patrol ships, and so on and so forth. But where it matters, where the money is going, and where the actual policy attention is going, is all in issues of cooperation on infrastructure and social issues. Do you think that's the case, or do you really see a lot of Canadian policy really seriously focusing on security, the old Cold War style security?
You're right for the first part. I think most of position of the Canadian government right now is internal. In fact, it's for internal politics. It's not for the rest of the world, like the Russian as well. You know, they're addressing their own constituency because the Arctic is a good, it's a rallying point. You know, nobody disagrees about being strong in the Arctic and the Canadian Arctic and so on. So you're right on that. Though I think in terms of the investment, I don't see it. Although there was no investment before, don't get me wrong, you know, I don't think the Liberal government we had 4 years did invest anymore, but the Conservatives are doing right now. There's no investment in the Arctic. There'll be investment through resource development. That's what's going to happen. What I'm afraid of is resource development doesn't necessarily mean social development. And I disagree on that idea, and right now the Canadian government is saying, you know, the only way to develop enough is through resource development. Resource development is important, but it's not a guarantee of social development. And we know from many examples that it doesn't work. If you don't make sure that social development is considered in resource development, then it won't happen together. So, and I think that's what's missing right now. And investment, you know, basic investment. I mean, they changed the food program in Northern Canada. The food program before that would cover more stuff, and now it covers less stuff, better food. But the price has been shooting up in the community. You talk about milk, I don't know, but orange juice, you know, 1 liter orange juice is $17, $18. The chicken can be $60 in some communities. Mind you, it's better if people eat land-based, you know, go hunting, because food is better than the chicken you can get there. Anyway, so there's lots of issues. It's not that simple, but I think, you know, that's it. The North is always, and that's another, yeah, it's another argument I haven't done, but you know, you talk about the frontier, you know, being the new frontier for Canada. And I understand that. But, you know, for the Inuit, it's an homeland. It's not a frontier. So we're still having that contradiction that we had for the Cree. Same story, you know, for Quebec. You know, is it a resource interland? Or is it the homeland of people that need to be part of what's happening on the land? We've been moving slowly in Quebec from that, the view of interland to homeland, not quite here yet, mind you, but we're moving towards that. But in Canada, we still have that view, so, you know, it's northern development is still seen as a new frontier, and I don't think it's a new frontier. It's getting the north inside Canada, making, you know, so, anyway.
My question is somewhat related. And earlier, you talked about security in Canada's presence in the region, or lack thereof. Last year, I guess, the federal government announced, I think, was the largest publicly tendered procurement contract in our history, $32 billion, I think, for shipbuilding, most of which went to the Irvings, a chunk also went to the Vancouver shipyard. I know some of this is destined for shipbuilding for the Arctic region. Do you think this will be noticeable in the region once this fleet has been developed?
I don't think so, because it's a military fleet. So it's an Arctic, those are patrol and offshore boats. And there's been a study done by Michael Bayer, I haven't time to read it, about the Titanic or whatever, blunder, something like that. Anyway, I'm not a shipping expert, maybe Adam can answer that, but those boats are not destined, they're not icebreakers. So they won't be able to open anything to anybody, they won't be able to give food to communities. So we're still much, it's military. It's military capacity, and military capacity can sometimes, like the Ranger is a good example. Ranger, it's a very interesting program because he used the strength of the people on the land. And I would argue that the Canadian Ranger are more efficient in terms of Canadian sovereignty than any boats or even sovereign unit, because they live on the land and they know, and that's one thing, people are talking about threat of illegal immigrants in the north. If you ever meet in the Navigoni, they'll know right away if somebody is an immigrant or illegal or whatever. So, in fact, the Inuit have the best eye on the Canadian North because they go on the land. They're always there. So they know what's happening. So there's not a... The Russian won't be able to slip by without somebody seeing them. If they even try, because I don't think they're that interested anyway. So... And, we're talking about terrorists, the same thing the Inuit will see, if there's somebody that's... It's hard to see terrorists in big cities, it's not hard to see them in a 300-people community. You'll know right away, so...
Well, I would disagree on patrol ships.
Yeah.
First, they're not military. They're going to be naval vessels operated by the Navy, but who operates them? And even that's kind of... most people are saying it's Coast Guard. But despite the fact that they're armed... Their purpose isn't to assert a presence, and their purpose certainly isn't to shoot down American planes or sink American icebreakers to defend sovereignty, or Russians, for that matter.
Not a good idea, but...
It would work out poorly for us, I believe. They're constabulary ships. Mm-hmm. I think that they're being built with the intention of policing the activity that everyone expects to be there in 5 to 10 years. The resource carriers, the oil tankers, all of that destinational shipping that I was talking about that everyone expects to be there, we would need an ability to police the area. And Michael Byers, I think, misses the point when he says, well, they're not icebreakers. Well, they're not supposed to be. They're not supposed to break ice. They are only supposed to really operate in the region during the shipping season, because that's when the shipping is there. That's when they're actually needed to be there to enforce environmental regulations, if necessary, to help with cleanups. So they're certainly not military ships. They're not meant to be military ships, even though they're armed. So it's a different way of looking at them.
Yeah, you can look at that, but I think when you look at all the fleet, the Chinese are getting 2 icebreakers. The Korean are getting an icebreaker. The Russian are updating their icebreakers. We have all icebreakers. So I would argue, if you want to control... Maybe having an icebreaker.
But of course, we're building an icebreaker as well.
Yeah.
The Devon.
Yeah. Okay. But
it's our strongest. It's already funded, so which means it's probably going to be built.
Yeah. Hopefully.
For our Arctic projects.
Because an icebreaker, I think, for all a sovereignty purpose and security purpose, is an icebreaker is a better solution because
absolutely.
We don't right now we have only summer icebreaker. We don't have a winter. Capacity icebreaker, which other country have?
Well, no, only Russia has that. Yeah. Only Russia has a winter breaking capability right now. And of course, if you asked Canadians if they wanted to invest in a multi-billion-dollar nuclear icebreaker, and we have in the past, and Canadians have said, no, we don't want that. But in the past, we've only needed that summer icebreaking capability, because no one else has the capability, aside from the Russians, to go in there. So why would we need it? In the future, we're going to need a heavier capability, and that's what the Diefenbaker is meant to do. So, the patrol ships run the constabulary duty, and police shipping that's up there, or will probably be up there. Well, the icebreaker does the Coast Guard duties, the ice breaking, the resupply, possibly the search and rescue if that's necessary. So it's sort of a dual purpose, multiple platforms for multiple purposes.
Anyway, now we'll see, because, but the thing is, it won't improve human security in the north, basically, I would say, in terms of those.
I don't think they're meant to.
No, they're not meant to either, but that's, in that sense, you know, we're still addressing, you know, issues, even if it's policing, and there's, I would argue there's more pressing issue in the north, but then...
Well, it might address human security in the sense that you do need to police oil and resource tankers.
Yeah.
You do need a presence there to ensure that pollution control regulations are being followed. Of course, you don't want... If there's an oil spill in, say, you know, Lancaster Sound, that very much affects human security.
Yeah, it does, but at the same time, you know, the thing is, you Canada can control it through the port. Those boats will go to Canadian port, being the Maris River or the, you know, destination shipping.
Sure.
So,
yeah.
You, anyway.
Yeah.
I'm going to intervene here and exercise moderator's privilege for the last question, which is more of an informational question rather than a question of argument. Can you tell us about the governance of these Inuit peoples, Athabaskan peoples, Sami? How do they go about selecting leaders to give their voice to presence on things like the Arctic, things like the
Arctic Council?
Yeah.
Well, it depends on the organization. If you look at ICCA, ICCA has a thing, it's a bit like the Arctic Council. They have a rotational presidency among the Inuit region. It's every 2 years, the meetings, and so they select, you know, and one country takes over the, you know, the international relation. And, so, and they elected. It's, in fact, it's through the Inuit organization from every Inuit region. So it's the way it works so far, and they change fairly often, and so it's so far I haven't heard any complaint, but representation is always an issue, and because they really, but what they bring at the table is really to make sure that human issues are brought, social issues are brought to the table in a way, and they've been fairly effective on that. So
just to add, and you raised it as well in your presentation, the fact that our chair is Inu. I don't think is insignificant. I think it was a strategic choice on the Prime Minister's part. And I know that she, leading up to her official chairmanship, she did a number of visits among the certain foreign nations. And when she was in Norway, she actually met separately with the Sami as well. So I think these things are on her radar, too.
You know, for sure. She's been part of that movement. She's been a minister in Nunavut, and she so, yeah, we'll see. We'll see the Canadian government support also a more involvement of Aboriginal people, and, you know, having a more social agenda on the Arctic Council, not only development. But we'll see.